International Accounting Standard number 36 deals with impairment losses. So first of all, what is the objective of this standard? This says that to ensure that assets are carried at no more than their recoverable amount and to define how recoverable amount is determined. For example, let's assume that the carrying amount of an asset is 150 million and recoverable amount of the asset is only 100 million. Then it means that asset is carried at more than 50 million in balance sheet. We can say that asset is overstated in balance sheet because it is more than the actual benefits of the assets. Now, IAS 36 is applicable on these type of assets such as land, building, plant and machinery, all property, plant and equipment that is covered under IAS 16, investment property carried at cost that is under IAS 40, intangible asset IAS 38, goodwill. Similarly, investments related to those investments which are related to subsidiaries, associates and joint ventures carried at cost, and those assets which carried at revalued amount under IAS 16 and IAS 38. That means those investment property which are carried at fair value, there is no need of application of IAS 36. Now let's talk about the definitions. Impairment loss. As we are studying impairment, so it's very important to know what is impairment loss. The amount by which carrying amount is greater than its recoverable amount. So if carrying amount of an asset exceeds its recoverable amount, the asset is subject to impairment loss. Now, what is carrying amount? We know that the value that is reflected in the balance sheet, that is the book value or net book value, is called carrying amount. The amount at which an asset is recognized in balance sheet after deduction of accumulated depreciation and accumulated impairment losses. Recoverable amount is the greater of an asset's fair value less cost of disposal, also known as net selling price, and its value in use. For example, value in use of an asset is 120 million and fair value less cost to sell is 125 million. Then the recoverable amount would be greater of 125 million. And then we will compare this recoverable amount with the carrying amount in order to determine the impairment loss. Now, how we can find out the fair value? So in order to find out fair value, the price that would be received to sell an asset or paid to transfer a liability. So fair value is the price in case of asset that we will receive when we sell that asset, but that price must be in an orderly transaction between market participants at the measurement date. And this definition has been written in IFRS 13, fair value measurement. So if you want to sell an asset, just determine the fair value and deduct the cost to sell, and you will get fair value less cost to sell. Now, as far as value in use is concerned, say suppose you're not selling that asset and you intend to utilize that asset over the useful life. So what would be the benefit? The benefit would be calculated as the present value of all future cash flows expected to be derived from an asset or cash generating unit. So ideally, the benefits during the life of the asset and at the time of disposal of the asset, that is the scrap value. So identify future cash flows, then use a suitable discount rate and determine the present value. And that present value would be value in use. Now, there are so many assets in the statement of financial position, so it's not possible to identify or to test each asset at the end of the reporting period. Now, let's say what is the requirement of identification of an impairment loss. So at the end of each reporting period, an entity is required to assess whether there is any indication that an asset may be impaired. IAS 36 has a list of external and internal indicators of impairment. If there is an indicator that an asset may be impaired, then the asset's recoverable amount must be calculated. So it's not necessary to test each asset separately at the end of the reporting period. Only those assets need to be tested for which some indicators are identified. But there are few assets which are to be tested annually, irrespective of any indicators. What are those assets? The recoverable amount of the following types of intangible assets are measured annually, whether or not there is any indication that it may be impaired. For example, an intangible asset having an indefinite useful life, an intangible asset not yet available for use, goodwill acquired in a business combination. So, an intangible asset with an indefinite useful life, such as brand name. An intangible asset not yet available for use, development cost, deferred development cost, or capitalized development cost, and positive goodwill. These assets, which are intangible assets, are subject to annual impairment testing. But other assets for which you have to find out the indicators, and those indicators might be internal indicators or external indicators. Now let's talk about internal and external indicators. One of the example of external source of information about the chances of an asset being impaired is the fall in market value, decline in market value. Suppose if you have a property and the market value of property goes down, then it's an indicator that it might be possible there is an impairment loss. So you have to test the values. Similarly, there are negative changes, not positive changes, in technology which you are using, in terms of the market in which you are operating, in terms of the overall economy, or in terms of the enactment of laws. For example, if the overall economy is going down, is in recession, or will going down to a recessionary situation, that indicates that asset might be overstated. Similarly, if a new technology has been adopted by the industry, by the companies, that there are chances that the asset concern that you are using might be fall in value. Same goes with laws and market. Similarly, increase in interest rate is an indicator of impairment. Why it is so? Because when we calculate value in use, this is PV of future cash flows, and we use interest rate as a discount rate. So if interest rate goes up, the PV goes down, hence the recoverable amount will be reduced. Similarly, the net assets of the company is higher than the market capitalization. Or you can say that the book value of the company's stock is, market value of the company's stock is less than book value. So market capitalization, that is the value of the company, is less than, and net assets value is greater than. That indicates that assets are overstated. Some internal source. One is the obsolescence or physical damage. Your asset has been damaged physically. Asset is idle. You're not using that asset. Part of a restructuring plan, or it is held for disposal. Similarly, you are expecting something from the asset, but asset is not performing as per your expectation. So these are few examples. And there might be very much examples. So these lists are not intended to be exhaustive. Further, an indication that an asset may be impaired may indicate that the asset's life, depreciation method, or residual value need to be reviewed and adjusted. It means that once there is an indicator of impairment lost and you are testing for that, you need to assess the useful life again, the method of depreciation, residual value, and this will be covered under change in accounting estimate, IAS 8. Now, determination of recoverable amount. If fair value less cost to sell or value in use is more than the carrying amount, it is not necessary to calculate the other amount. The asset is not subject to impairment. For example, the carrying amount is 150 and you calculated first value and this is 160. Now there is no need to calculate fair value less cost to sell because there will be no impairment loss as recoverable amount is more than the carrying amount. If fair value less cost to disposal cannot be determined, then recoverable amount is only value in use. Sometimes it's possible that fair value is not, cannot be determined, or you're not intend to sell that asset. In such case, the recoverable amount is only value in use. But for assets to be disposed of, recoverable amount is only fair value less cost of sale. For example, in case of asset held for sale, fair value less cost of disposal. Fair value is to be determined in accordance with IFRS 13 fair value measurement. We have already discussed the definition. Cost of disposal are the direct added cost only, not existing cost or overhead. What is value in use? The calculation of value in use should reflect the following elements: an estimate of the future cash flows that the entity expect to derive from the asset, and expectation about possible variation in the amount or timing of those future cash flows. Now we have to estimate these future cash flows and then find out a suitable discount rate and then calculate the present value of future cash flows, and that becomes the value in use. For example, you are expecting the remaining life is 3 years and the benefit you are expecting in year one, year two, year three is 100,000, 80,000 and 70,000. So you have determined future cash flows, then find out the suitable discount rate. Let's assume that the discount rate is 10%. So in year one, the factor is 0.909. In year two, 0.826. In year three, 0.751. Now what you have to do is to just multiply cash flow with the discount factor and you will get the present value of future cash flows. So this is the a basic idea about the treatment of impairment losses. In the next video, we'll discuss how we can project future cash flows, what would be the accounting treatment of impairment losses, what is cash generating unit, and if reversal take place, then how to record the reversal of impairment losses.